very much for this incredible opportunity to be with you. Thank you to the San Diego Democrats and to the Rancho Santa Fe Democrats. Let's recap what we heard today. We heard a lot of great vision, we heard about promises, but we didn't hear about how you actually pay for programs. Right? And who has backed up with those promises with actually a specific idea for paying for all of this. The four of us, as you heard, share a progressive vision. So the question is, who do you trust to implement that vision? And who has the fiscal expertise and proven track record to get the job done? Look at my record. Look at the recession. Look at the crisis. I fought to save California's jobs. Who fought to protect our environment? I fought to protect our environment. And who came up with a specific plan to tackle sexual harassment? I'm the only one on this stage. But I also stood up when no other Democrat would fight. I was the one who took on Governor Schwarzenegger when everybody cowered and he ran roughshod over California. Today, you look at the people of color, you look at immigrants, you look at women. Wells Fargo's preying upon those who are unempowered. I'm the one, I was the first state elected official going after Wells Fargo. That's the I'm the one fighting for retirement security. I push for secure choice, right? Because when you have so many women and of low income working all the years, taking after their kids, and they're going to retire in poverty, that's not what California is, and that's not who I am about. And so who did this in the midst? Who led us through that recession? Who led that through us through that financial crisis? That answers your question, Holly. I did. Right? When people needed a trusted voice in Sacramento to fight for the people first and politicians later, I fought for all of you first. So who do you trust? Who do you trust to implement this vision? Who do you trust to get the numbers right? Who do you trust to take on President Trump? I mentioned I took him on housing, I take him on immigration, I take him on healthcare, with Helly's assistance. So I think at the end of the day, when you ask yourself the question, who has the proven track record, who has the integrity, I respectfully ask for your vote. So I think I can lead California to the promised land, the one of aspiration for all our people. Thank you very much.
Thank you all, fellow Democrats, for being here and for being wonderful Democrats. All over the state, I've been meeting these amazing groups of people. I think we're turning this state bluer than blue again, and not too soon either. I would say to all of you, I'm here running for governor. I thought I was done politically. I had stepped off the stage. I'd had a full life. I was in city government, then I was at the state assembly, and then I was a superintendent of public instruction, and I was in charge of over 40% of the state of California budget. So I'm the only candidate up here who's had those three levels of service. And I will tell you, I learned a lot in every single one of them, but I thought I was done. And then I stepped to the side and I watched as California disinvested in education. Terribly. I watched as housing prices skyrocketed. I watched as we didn't develop health care for all. And I saw us not making the commitment to our environment. I'm fond of saying, of course we should ban fracking. We had earthquakes before they were fashionable. And seriously, why would we put poison water into our ground? It's ridiculous. And so we've got to have somebody who's got the courage, the vision, and the heart. That's what's missing in California. We have 2/3 majorities in both houses of the legislature. And we've got all constitutional officers, and yet we have the highest number and percentage of poor children in America. We have the highest number and percentage of homeless children. Somebody needs to lead the state to make the changes that we owe to the people and to the next generation. Children are living messages we send to a time we'll never see. And our message to the future really ought to be, we ought to be building colleges and universities, not prisons, to take five. In that same period of time, we built 23 prisons. Those are not my values, and I haven't met a single California Democrat who thinks they're theirs either. Time for a change, ladies and gentlemen. And oh, by the way, it would be kind of nice to have a woman governor.
Thank you for caring enough about your county, the state, and the nation to be here. You know, what motivates me to run for governor? I believe in that notion that to whom much is given, much is expected. I grew up in a Coral Heights, a community of, that was fairly poor. It was the Ellis Island in Los Angeles. I grew up at a time when many of us had to struggle to make ends meet, where most of us weren't homeowners, where many of us didn't have health care. And my entire life, I've stood up for the notion that that was wrong, that we could do better than that. I'm running for governor because I want to restore the luster of the California dream. Yes, this is a great state, and we are growing better than we have in the past, but we could do a much better job. Look at the level of homelessness that you have in San Diego, that I have in Los Angeles, that you have in San Diego. Look at the level of poverty that we have. We can't call ourselves progressive, everybody, and not care about the fact that we're not growing together. My whole life I stood up for that. That's why I was a community organizer for 25 years. That's why I was fighting these fights long before I ran for office. Because the next governor's got to care about the fact that we've left too many people behind, that kids are starting school 3 million words behind, as was mentioned earlier, that too many people are living in poverty. I want to be a governor that stands up for a great California, a California where we're growing together, a California that says we can't leave that number children behind, that says we've got to redirect the prison pipeline to a pipeline of hope and opportunity. I would be honored to have your support. Thank you very much for being here today. Please have a good night. Thanks for calling in, all of you. We're in San Diego. In 1994, you had a guy very familiar to all of you who was standing on stage running for re-election as governor. California by the name of Pete Wilson. In 1994, he was out there promoting xenophobia and nativism. Proposition 187, 1994. The UC Regents, they weren't debating, you know, tuition increases, they were debating ending affirmative action. 1994, three strikes reform was on the ballot. All of those things won. Every initiative, Pete Wilson won his re-election. He was in the ascendancy, the Republican Party was in its ascendancy. Fast forward today. A week ago, it came out that the Republican Party in the state of California is within 1 percentage point of being third party status. The majority minority state now, a state that doesn't tolerate its diversity, a state that is now celebrating that diversity. A universal state, a state that's brought in 112,000 refugees just in the last 15 years, 1,434 Syrian refugees. It's a point of pride, a point of principle, and it's also a point of contrast to Washington, D.C. and all the headwinds. You need a governor at this critical moment that has your back. You need a governor that can push back, not just to be the head of the resistance, but to design a positive alternative agenda that can advance the values of this state all across the United States of America. If you want timidity, I'm not your guy. If you want someone who stepped up and stepped in on marriage equality before anybody else, I'm your guy. We took on the National Rifle Association last year with Proposition 63 that had the courage of his convictions to stand up and fight for the decriminalization and legalization of marijuana. I'm gonna be bold. I'm going to be proud standing up for the values of the state. I'd be honored for your support to be the next governor of the great state of California.